I will speak about the central monoaminergic systems. So I give you a link to eventually look a little bit more to one of my publications, where this is a little bit of history and the state of the art of monoaminergic treatment that we will see later. But here, I will try to give you an overview of the function of monoaminergic system. So, what are the monoamines? Monoamines are dopamine, noradrenaline, adrenaline, serotonin, and histamine. So, dopamine, noradrenaline, and adrenaline have the same precursor and are called catecholamines. Catecholamines because you have the residue catechol, which is a benzene plus two hydroxyls in position 3 and 4, and radical here, which is R, and the amine function NH2. So be aware that at physiological pH, NH2 is NH3+, so positive charge. So you have catecholamines. Then you have serotonin with the indole nucleus, and in red, in green here, this is the indole nucleus with the amine function, and this is for serotonin. And histamine, sometimes it is called a diamine, but so this is, I don't know, because in periphery it is destroyed by diaminase, but for most people histamine is a monoamine. And to avoid the problem, we call also these molecules biogenic amines. So, what is the functional roles of these amines? We don't exactly know, because these are divergent systems. So, go back on the course of neurotransmitter systems. Here, these are divergent systems, so that it is quite complicated to understand their function. They are almost everywhere. So, what I can say in terms of physiology and pathophysiology is that serotonin is involved in awareness, feeding behavior, stress, hormonal regulation, thermoregulation, nociception, sexual behavior, learning, attention, memory, and a lot of other things. And of course, serotonin is known because it is a target of antidepressant and anxiolytic drugs, also for obsessive compulsive disorders, also in schizophrenia, addiction, bipolar disorder, etc., etc. So it does not mean that serotonin induces those diseases, but at least we can play serotonergic system to modify these diseases, and sometimes appropriately. Dopamine is more known for its implication in motor behavior, cognition, emotion, motivation, and neuroendocrine function. It is targeted in Parkinson's disease, schizophrenia, addiction, depression, etc., obsessive compulsive disorder as well, impulsivity, etc., etc. And probably also feeding behavior. And noradrenaline, it is present in CNS, in the central nervous system and periphery. It is involved in several function, brain function, and more known for sleep. I mean, like serotonin anyway, arousal. But sleep, arousal, attention, learning, and memory, and due to its targeting by some antidepressant drugs, it is a target in depression, anxiety, and also attention deficit disorders. So, serotonin is involved everywhere. I just gave you here an example of its function, but this is not true for all serotonin cells. Some cells are chemoreceptors, means that they are sensitive to small changes of pH. And small changing of pH means probably there is something like acidosis, so deficit in respiration, so that the quantity of oxygen is reduced, while the quantity of carbon dioxide is increased. This is acidosis. So here I gave you an example of one neuron, one serotonergic neurons, and these are experiments done in vitro. So you cut slice of a brain, and then you insert a pipette to do intracellular recordings. Using these intracellular recordings, you can measure the firing rate of one neuron in your slice. Then, the pH is controlled at pH 7.4, physiological pH. And then it is transiently reduced to 7.2. And the consequence is that this neuron increases its firing rate. So if you are starting at 0.3, you go to, I don't know, even something like 1.5, it means that this is 500% increase, so this is a huge increase, even if the basal firing rate is quite low. And when you go back to 7.4, you go back to normal firing rate. Then a new and longer period of pH set 7.2, and then you can see the increase in the pH, in the firing rate, go back, etc., etc. So it looks like this cell is involved in chemoreception. This is a cell which is present in the dorsal raphe nucleus. Then these authors try to label this cell and characterize in terms of phenotype, the cell. And to do that, you can label, you can target with antibody enzymes specifically involved in the synthesis of serotonin, and this is tryptophan hydroxylase. So they did that, and you can see in green the cell expressing tryptophan hydroxylase, and they label also blood vessels to show that one of the dendrites here is somehow connected to these blood vessels. So it means that in addition to react to modification of pH, this cell anatomically interact with blood vessel, and the dorsal raphe nucleus is not so far from the ventricles, the fourth ventricle. So it means that it is close to the zona where you can directly have modification of pH. So this cell detects modification of pH. But other cells detect something like, I don't know, modification of glucose, modification of temperature, stress conditions, locomotor activity, etc., etc. So you don't have uniformity in serotonin cells. So I switch to the other slide, which concern dopamine neurons function. So you know probably dopamine. You know probably dopamine as being involved in some disease. But what is their function? So in the 90s, Wolfram Schultz conducted some experiments where he found that dopamine neurons in the mesencephalon, in the ventral tegmental area, and we forget this, but and the substantia nigra pars compacta, were reacting to reward. For instance, if you give one stimulus in the, before this, I have to explain you that a glass micropipette has been inserted in the ventral tegmental area or the substantia nigra pars compacta to measure extra cellular cell recordings. So here we are measuring extracellular cell signals. Then, if you give a stimulus A here, you almost don't trigger action potential. So it looks like this is neutral and without interest. And then the authors, at that time Wolfram Schultz, present some time after a reward, something which is appetitive, which triggers action potentials in dopaminergic neurons. So they did that experiment several times, so to couple the stimulus which was not pertinent to the reward. And after learning, because this is a sort of learning or conditioning, then the presentation of the stimulus which was not pertinent induced firing rate of dopamine neurons, and then at the presentation of the reward, the dopaminergic neurons did not fire. So it looks like there was a transfer from the reward to the non-pertinent stimulus. In fact, the both are coupled now, so this is a sort of conditioning. If you give a pertinent stimulus B before, then you give a pertinent stimulus A and you shunt the response of dopaminergic neurons associated with stimulus A. And finally, the last example here is if you give the stimulus A, you trigger dopamine neuron activity, and if you omit the reward, then there is a transient decrease in the firing rate of dopaminergic neurons. So it looks like they can also code for aversive situations. It induced something. A last example, this is for noradrenaline. So here this is an experiment in rats, in alive rats with microdialysis, and the authors induce a stress, classical stress. So imagine you pinch the tail of a rat, so he's not really happy. And then if you follow the extracellular levels of noradrenaline in the cortex and probably in other brain regions, then you can evaluate, you can monitor an increase in extracellular levels of noradrenaline during the pinch. So it lasts also maybe 15 to 30 minutes after the cessation of the pinch. So just to highlight here the involvement of noradrenaline in the stress. Now I switch to dysfunction of these systems. So it is evident in Parkinson's disease. So if you look at this slide, you see the classical posture of a Parkinson patient on this statue, characterized by motor troubles, and they have postural instability, rigidity, bradykinesia, means slowness of movement, or in the more severe form, akinesia, and tremor at rest. Not eight, but at only. So these are the cardinal point of the classical symptoms of Parkinson's disease. Now, especially because those were correct by anti-Parkinsonian treatment, there are some non-motor troubles, including cognitive troubles, anxiety, depression. And here this is not clear the extent to which dopamine is involved. And probably you have the involvement of other abnormalities on neurotransmission systems other than dopamine. But we don't know. So maybe serotonin, maybe noradrenaline, we don't know. And the point is, we can discuss about the consequence of alteration of one monoaminergic system, here dopamine, But in case of serotonin or noradrenaline, it is more difficult because we don't have a clear relationship between alteration of serotonin or noradrenaline systems and impairment of brain functions. So even if people are speaking about serotonin and depression, this is bullshit. We don't exactly know. And if it was true, then we could highlight something in rodents, because in rodents it is clear, like in humans, that antidepressant drugs need the serotonin and or noradrenergic system to work. But if you remove serotonin system, you can destroy them. If you remove noradrenaline system, if you remove both of them simultaneously, then what is the consequence? Rats are lying and they don't present sort of mood disorders in in behavioral test. Everything seems to be fine. So this is dangerous to say that these systems are involved. Somehow they are probably involved, but probably not the main point. So that's the reason why I can only make the parallel between dysfunction and disease in the case of Parkinson's disease. For other diseases in the brain, this is more complicated. And you will see on the publication that we cannot go so far. So I start now the monoaminergic system, and I start by describing this central monoaminergic system. There are clusters of cell bodies for serotonin, dopamine, and noradrenaline. So cell bodies are quite organized in some specific brain region that we will see. And they are together, where the density is quite elevated. So for the distribution of these systems, we can do several different techniques. And because, okay, so the distribution, you can imagine, how can you determine the distribution of one molecule? Of course, you have to go through the chemical properties of this molecule, and for monoamines you have different possibilities. You can detect them in the beginning. It was histofluorescence. You can also detect them, and it was close to the beginning, by the fact that they can be oxidized. So you can take part of the brain and look at the concentration of the different monoamines in different parts of the brains. So for instance, on this slide called Punch of Brain Areas, this is post-mortem, whatever usually you are measuring or evaluating the distribution of monoamines post-mortem. So for instance, here you see the picture of a brain with four punch in each part of the striatum, left and right, with the dorsomedial, dorsolateral, ventrolateral, and ventromedial part of the striatum. And you can look at the, to take this part and to analyze the concentration of each monoamine in this part of the brain, just to give an idea about the concentration of monoamines in part of the brain. Then, to do that, I switch to the other slide called postmortem dosage. So after the sacrifice, you dissect, dissection means, as I show you, the punch. Then you put the punch in liquid. You give ultrasound to destroy the piece of tissue. So now this is red and homogeneous to symbolize homogeneity. But you have fragment of cells, mitochondria, or I don't know. So this is not good to inject in some system. Then you do centrifugation and you collect the supernatant. The supernatant, which contain the molecule of interest, and you inject the supernatant in HPLC system. Here this is a whole one, so high pressure liquid chromatography and electrochemical detection. So why this is interesting? Because you can see here noradrenaline in the yellow rectangle, noradrenaline, which can give under with voltage, which can be oxidized, and you see here that the hydroxyl function gave cetones plus two protons plus two electrons. And the two electrons, this is current, and you can, with appropriate device, measure this current. So for instance, here you have a chromatogram, and just look above, where you have, in time and the production of current, noradrenaline, DOPAC, which is a metabolite of dopamine, dopamine, 5-hydroxyindole acetic acid, which is a metabolite of serotonin, HVA, which is a metabolite also of dopamine, and 5-hydroxytryptamine serotonin. So with this, you can measure the quantity of all monoamines. So, do we have heterogeneity of these monoamines in terms of quantity in the brain? And so, I skip to the slide called neurochemical heterogeneity. So, don't learn this, of course, but it is just to show you, if you pay a little bit attention on noradrenaline, dopamine, and 5-HT, serotonin, you will see that the concentration of noradrenaline is quite homogeneous in the brain. I mean, quite homogeneous in those brain regions. So, the orbital cortex, the frontal cortex, the striatum, in fact, the striatum, this is the region where you have the less concentration of noradrenaline, amygdala, hippocampus, subthalamic nucleus. So this is quite homogeneous, and this is similar for serotonin. Serotonin, probably the highest concentration in the brain, but this is not here, this is in the substantia nigra, pars compacta. But if you pay attention to dopamine, dopamine is really low in the cortex, I mean in the orbital cortex. It is quite low in the frontal cortex, even if this is, it looks like important, this is quite low. And then this is absolutely high in the striatum, the nucleus accumbens, shell and core. This is curiously high. Then this is quite elevated in the ventral tegmental area and substantia nigra. This is modest in the basolateral and central nucleus of the amygdala. And this is poor in hippocampus, even non-detectable here, and subthalamic nucleus. So the highest heterogeneity is for dopamine. So I have another example of this neurochemical heterogeneity, striatum, cortex, cerebellum, but here this is just for checking the consequence of the lesion of 6-hydroxy of dopaminergic neurons using 6-hydroxy dopamine. So you can skip this example. So as I told you, also in the beginning there was histofluorescence, and it was the first technique. And you, using this first technique, it was seen some clusters of monoaminergic nucleus. And Dahlstrom and Fuchs used the method of Falk and ELAP to observe the aminergic nuclei in the brain. And they gave a sort of nomenclature that is still used. If you see A1, A2, blah, 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 it is relative to the nomenclature of Dahlstrom and Fuchs. So, but with the histofluorescence technique, you just see the cell body. This is more complicated to see the fibers just because the background is quite elevated. So there are other techniques. For instance, here, this is an anterograde tracing. So you inject something at the level of the cell bodies and you measure in other parts of the brain. So trying to do sort of reconstruction of the labeling you can have. So this technique based on radio labeled amino acid. So you inject by stereotaxic procedure the radiolabeled compound in anesthetized rats, and then 1 week later you kill the animals and you check for the radioactivity in all parts of the brain. So you can measure whether or not there are some fibers. So this is not perfect. But this is with this kind of technique that we could appreciate the projection of serotonin cells in the brain and the way they did it. So if you look at the right side, and the legend is frontal section of braids obtained 1 week after the injection of 3-H leucine. you have some spot of radioactivity, particularly in the thalamus, etc. This corresponds to the medial forebrain bundle, so it looks like fibers share this location to go in the anterior part of the brain. So nowadays you have other techniques. You can label tryptophan hydroxylase. You can also label serotonin directly with antibodies, and it was the first guy who did it was Harry Steinbusch in Netherlands. You can also label, I think, dopamine, but you can also label tyrosine hydroxylase. You can also label, now that we know the proteins, some proteins, the transporter for serotonin, which will label specifically serotonin cells, or for dopamine, or for noradrenaline, etc., etc. So nowadays we have some specific markers. And you can also use transgenic mice. For instance, you can couple to the promoter of tyrosine hydroxylase, a protein like CTB or I don't know, or GFP, to label specifically, in case of tyrosine hydroxylase, catecholaminergic neurons and fibers, for instance. So, based on all these techniques, and okay, I will give you here some tips about the distribution of these neurons. Sometimes, curiously, we don't exactly know what is going on. For instance, close to the striatum, we have the globus pallidus, and we don't exactly know what is going in the globus pallidus. Probably fibers coming from the substantia nigra and coming from also the ventral tegmental area. So this is weird. So here I can give you the main circuits that we know. So first, what you have, I don't have even text here. No. So follow my voice and eventually, if you have it, your PowerPoint. We have A9, which is located, and A9 is projecting to the striatum. So this is the substantia nigra pars compacta, which project to the striatum, and it is called the nigrostriatal dopaminergic pathway. You have A8, which is the retrorubral nucleus, and A8 is projecting in the striatum and probably a little bit in the nucleus accumbens and perhaps somewhere else. One of the most famous also is A10 or area of Tsai, but you can say the ventral tegmental area, which is projecting to a little bit of the anterior and ventral part of the striatum. Sorry, but here, the nucleus accumbens, the bed nucleus of the stria terminalis, the cortical parts, the olfactive tubercles and a little bit in the amygdala and probably the hippocampus. And the last, no, not the last, the also known dopaminergic pathway is the tubero-infundibular pathway. This is called like this because it comes from A12, which is located in the hypothalamus, which project to the pituitary gland. And it controls neuroendocrine function, including the production of and the release of prolactin. So you have A8, A9, A12, A10, and A12. So what about A11? We don't exactly know. It is less well characterized. Could be in between A12 and A10, somewhere lost in the mesencephalon. And perhaps A11 could do a local projection, and I think, yeah, dopaminergic, and it is suspected to go and to be responsible for the origin of dopamine in the spinal cord. But dopamine in the spinal cord is quite low. So here we are finishing the first point dedicated to the different monoaminergic pathways, so the dopaminergic system here with cell bodies located in A8 retrohumoral nucleus, A9 the substantia nigra pars compacta nucleus, A10 the ventral tegmental area, and A12 the hypothalamus. Then we have A11. A11, which is bizarre. And I just said it was middle of nothing in between the hypothalamus and the mesencephalon, probably in the mesencephalon, and it could be responsible for the descending dopaminergic pathway from the brainstem to the spinal cord. Because we actually have a little bit of dopamine in the spinal cord, but it has been always a matter of debate, not really well appreciated, not really well studied. And still, some people with reasons are interested by this dopaminergic tone in the spinal cord. So you see in this drawing, you have nothing going to the spinal cord, but probably this is, this is somewhere here. Not clear. Okay. The noradrenergic system. So noradrenaline is also a catecholamine, and like dopamine was included in the catecholamines nuclei in the brain. So noradrenaline to adrenaline, to at least dopamine, this is A1 to A12, at least. I think after that you have A13 or something like that, but this, I don't know them even. So the noradrenergic system, there are several nuclei. The main one, the one that you have to remember is A6. A6 is in the medulla, the dorsal part of the medulla, and can innervate all parts of the brain. So from the locus ceruleus to the hippocampus, and definitely all parts of the brain. So this is A6 in yellow. It is a dorsal and ventral ascending noradrenergic pathway. So it uses the medial forebrain bundle as well. The locus ceruleus is constituted by more than 50% of noradrenergic neurons, and 80% are ipsilateral. But we have also additional nuclei, not A1 or A2, A1 or A2. There, which are going to the spinal cord, but A5 here and A7. A5 and A7. So they are projecting in the septum and the hypothalamus. So I have done recently some dosage of noradrenaline in the hypothalamus, and it is quite elevated, more than the region that I present. And this is something like 1 nanogram per milligram of tissue. Maybe a little bit less, but this is quite elevated. As well, some thalamic nuclei are concentrated in noradrenaline. So for some brain region, we have the combination of different origin. And I will finish by the serotonergic system. The serotonergic system, the nomenclature from Dahlström and Fuchs is B1 to B9. And these nuclei are organized, as you can see here, in the from the medulla to the mesencephalon. I mean the dorsal part of the mesencephalon. Then, most of these nuclei, at least from B1 to B5, are responsible for the innervation of serotonin cells of the spinal cord. So you have a huge projection of serotonin in the spinal cord, in all parts of the spinal cord. It's like noradrenaline. You have a dense projection to the spinal cord from the cervical, thoracic, lumbar, and sacral regions of the spinal cord. If you look in details, you could have some distinct part of the spinal cord which can be more innervated compared to others, but whatever, you have innervation of the spinal cord. And then the nuclei where you can find serotonin cells projecting to the brain are B7, the dorsal raphe nucleus, and B8, 9, the medial raphe nucleus. So in the dorsal raphe nucleus, 50% of the cells of the neurons are of serotonergic phenotype. In the raphe median nucleus, 5% of serotonin of cells are serotonergic. So in contrast to other cells, I mean, for monoamides, I don't know, but these ones you have no myelin or oligodendrocyte around the axon. Like the other monoamines, the axon is quite thin, so the conduction is quite low, especially for serotonin. So it means that the speed of conduction is lower than 1 meter per second. It is like fiber C in the dorsal root of dorsal root ganglia.